one can actually compare this Kerala school with Greek period. Like there was Greek tradition, we had one session on Greek tradition, like Socrates, Plato, Pythagoras, Euclid, Aristotle, Archimedes, and so on. There are so many more also, Apollonius and things like that. So that was Greek school where there is a teacher and disciple relationship. The teacher and then next generation disciple, and then disciple will become a teacher and further descendants, and the school will grow. And most of the discourses will be oral. Okay. So the Kerala school is comparable with such exchange of knowledge. And Madhav being the pioneer of this school. So he founded this school in 14th century. See, the period he lived is not very clear, because this is all unsung story. Anyways, people know very little about this Kerala school. Of late, in last whatever 50-60 years, there is more literature on Madhava school, Madhava and Kerala school. But roughly speaking, it is 1350. His birth year could be 1350, Madhava's. So he must have born in 14th century, so mid 14th century taken birth. And then he was a great scholar. Remember that most of the ancient Indian mathematicians were interested in astronomy for obvious reasons, because one looks at the sky and then you wonder that from where all this glazing comes from, how to justify this, how to justify the movement. Then there were models, geocentric, heliocentric, things like that. In fact, if I get chance to mention, it's it, some quasi-heliocentric model was developed by actually this Kerala school, okay, where some of the planets will revolve around sun, but sun will revolve around Earth. So there was some in-between thing, quasi-heliocentric, but I will come to that later if I get time. So this Kerala school started by Madhava in 14th century, and his actually major work comes the beginning of the 15th century. And it continued almost up to beginning of the 17th century. So it's a long tradition of very scholarly mathematics coming from India, but remained unnoticed for a long period until 1940, one can say. So more than 300 years, it was not in picture at all. And so many Western mathematicians, especially the European Renaissance period, came in. Generally, it is believed that the Renaissance is in 15th century Europe. Okay. 15th century Europe. And then there is a galaxy of mathematicians coming from Europe. There were great schools like Oxford, Cambridge, Göttingen, Ecole Polytechnique, Ecole Normale, everywhere in Europe, like France, Germany, Great Britain, everywhere, the explosion of knowledge took place after 15th century, and galaxy of mathematicians. The major contributions came from Newton, Leibniz, Gauss, Riemann, Lagrange, so many. There are hundreds of names you can take, Lagrange, okay, so on. And this Madhav and his school started from this and ended around 1620 or something like this. And this period is in between, okay, with this European Renaissance. And this entire work remained unnoticed until 1940, so much of late, where people recognized that there was something in it, something in this Kerala school. They started digging up the matter, and then some articles came up. And then now, in last 50-60 years, it is almost at the stage of recognition that the work carried out by Madhava and his disciples is of highest quality and surpasses some of the work carried out in the Renaissance period in Europe. So with this hypothesis, let me start that what we want to hear actually in this lecture is that is this unsung story, what they did and what credit they could have got, but they did not. And then even today, the full credit of work that they have done is not with them. So let's see the next. So before we actually go into Madhava's work, we would like to understand Indian mathematics before Madhava. Now, can somebody, some of you tell now after this 14 lectures, let me ask you questions that we talked about so much of history in this lecture series. So can somebody at least roughly tell what must have been before Madhava? Can you tell some names or traditions in Indian mathematics before Madhava? Is before 14th century.
भट्टाचार्य,
हाँ,
आर्य भट्टाचार्य,
आर्यभट्टा. हाँ, ओके. हाँ, आर्यभट्टा.
बराहमीर वाज आल्सो, बट ही वाज नॉट इन मैथ्स, बट स्टिल एस्ट्रोलॉजी.
He was very much in maths, Varaha
ओके सर.
See, in that period, maths, astronomy, even today, astronomy is part of mathematics. One may call applied mathematics, but tools used are geometric tools. It's a geometry extended to planetary motions. Okay. Varaha Mihir. Anything else? Now, this, what I'm writing, can you see this, what I'm writing?
Yes,
Mandar?
sir. Yes, sir. We
Ah,
can see,
okay.
sir.
Yeah. Even before that, there was something called Vedic period. We went through lecture on this. And there is.
Jain Munis also. I don't remember right now the names, but you had mentioned Jain Munis' names.
Jain
Jain Mathematics.
school. Let me write Jain school. Anything else? This Dhanashree gave lectures on ancient Indian mathematics. You must have Bhaskara, that's a prominent name.
Sir, I had missed that lecture. Sorry to say, I had missed.
Okay.
Lilavati.
Bhaskaracharya,
Brahma Bhat
the author of the
Lilavati.
book Lilavati, yes. There is something called Sulba Sutra. Sulba Sutras is rules of rope. So this mathematics came before Madhava. And two prominent names I will write here. Aryabhatta, which I have written there, but there are two Aryabhattas, remember. So this I will write Aryabhatta 2 and Bhaskara 2. So there was Aryabhatta 1 and Aryabhaskara 1. They lived at the beginning of the Christian era, CE. And Aryabhatta 2 and Bhaskara 2, Aryabhatta was 11th century and Bhaskara was roughly 12th, 13th century. Okay. So these are immediate predecessors of Madhava, Aryabhatta 2 and Bhaskara 2. So we will see impact of these two Indian mathematicians on Madhava school or Kerala school. Okay, so let's see. See this table. We go back to 3000 to 1500 BC. Okay, and name of the mathematicians are not visible there, but there were weighing machines, geometrical figures were there. Circle is very ancient. Circle being so symmetric and smooth object. It's a very ancient object, and some geometrical figures related to circle, semicircle, sectors were there. Ancient civilization definitely needed geometry as well as arithmetic in the sense commercial mathematics like weighing machines. Then 1500 to 500, this is called Vedang, Sulba Sutra, astronomy, arithmetic, circle, all these. this Vedangas, which are parts of Veda, this is Vedic mathematics, these contain knowledge on this arithmetic especially. And astronomy was always a curiosity for mathematicians right from Vedic period or even before that. And the main mathematicians featured in this period are Buddhayana, Apasthambayana, and Katyayana. Then somebody told Jain mathematics, that is true, 500 to 200 BC. And in that period, number theory and some permutation combination, counting problems started, astronomy. Throughout, you can see astronomy. Then 200 to 400, decimal system came. Use of zero. This is Aryabhatta 1, who is generally given the credit of inventing zero. And we say that zero is Indian invention. Simultaneous equation, quadratic equation, some algebra you can see. And the most importantly, the decimal equations. Okay, decimal. Decimal system is most important contribution of the Indian system. We will get chance to talk on the decimal system later. Okay. See, the infinitesimal nature of the decimal system was recognized much later. And the justification of the convergence of infinite series associated with the decimal system came much, much later. But the system as such came into existence much, much earlier, as earliest as 200 BC, and came from Indian mathematicians. Same is with the use of zero and things like that. Okay. These are very important Indian contributions. Okay. And this 400 to 1200, generally part of it is called dark period. Nothing much happened. But then in terms of Indian mathematics, there are important mathematicians. For example, this Lilavati, which contains several algebraic methods, arithmetic methods, Bijagandhita, also rules of algebra. And then this important, all the mathematicians, the names you told, Aryabhatta 1, Varahamir, Bhaskara, Brahmagupta, Sridhara, Mahavir, Bhaskaracharya, this is Bhaskaracharya 2. Okay. And then on this background, this 400 AD, or now sometimes it is nomenclature is CE, Christian era, this Kerala school came into existence. Okay. So this Madhava, Parameshwara, Nilkantha, Jyeshtadeva, we'll see the ancestry as like this. So this ancestry is like this. It is slightly faint. Mandar, this color scheme is little faint. Can you see this?
Yes, yes, I can see, sir.
Can you read? Somebody can read this. Madhava, then?
Parameshwara.
Huh?
Damodara.
Who is reading?
Mandar.
No, Mandar, you have written, so somebody else I want. Can, is it really visible?
Yes,
it is.
It is visible? Is it visible?
Yes.
Can you read?
Yes.
Please read.
Neelakanta.
Madhava, Parameshwara, Damodara, Neelakanta, Jyeshtadeva.
Then Shankara.
Shankara
Achyuta.
Actually, this Jyeshtadeva and Nilkanta both taught Shankara.
Okay.
And this Damodara is Parameshwara's son, actually. And Parameshwara lived very long life, as you can see, 1360 to 1455, so almost 95 years. Okay. So he taught the son's disciples also. Okay. Old man was there in the house. And actually, the teacher was Damodara for Nilkantha and Jyeshtadeva. But there are references in Nilkantha's work, because both these wrote books. For example, Nilakantha produced a book called Tantra Sangra. And Jyeshtadeva is Yukti Bhasha. And in these books, there are references of Parameshwara. Parameshwara was a very great mathematician. I mean, Madhava was a founder, and everyone in this school attributed their success to Madhava ultimately. Therefore, it is called Madhava and Kerala School. Madhava School of Mathematics. Madhava was the main person, of course, who started all this. And he attracted Parameshwara. Parameshwara was also a great scholar. And therefore, things continued. Okay. So this is ancestry of the Kerala school. She lived up to 1620, starting with 1350 in some sense. Okay. So this was rough. These are names. In Kim Pockler's book, okay, there is a great book by Kim Pockler, German lady, a very scholar, historian of mathematics. And she has discussed the caste system in Kerala also at that time. And looking at this period, we think that the caste system must have been very prominent at that period. But not all of them were actually Brahmins. For example, Shankara was given equal status even at that time in this Kerala school, where the knowledge was transcended from one person to the other and caste system was very rigid. But in Kerala, it was not so. You can see references to this. Okay. So this was a liberal school of knowledge, and all interested could take part in this exchange of mathematical ideas. Main interest was always astronomy. Astronomy was main interest. But whatever needed, they did on their own. Whatever ingredients they wanted, they created those ingredients also on their own. Therefore, in the process, they created some pure mathematics also. And I will come to the main invention, which is actually very stunning or amazing, that is calculus. How many of you know the meaning of these two words, astronomy and calculus? Roughly, what astronomy deals with and what calculus deals with? Anyone?
Astronomy with planetary motions and position of planets. And calculus is, I think it is below the curve, how we calculate the area, how it changes with time, or like those things. We compare the things with respect to something. That is calculus.
Compare. Little tricky word. Compare is not fully wrong also, but then it's not sufficient also. There are ratios, so there is comparison, of course, but then only ratios don't matter. So main thing in calculus is limiting processes. Limiting processes. Now I cannot go into details of what limit means, but this deals with infinitesimally small and infinitesimally large also. So infinitely small and infinitely large. Infinitely large. Okay. And there are two main processes involved. Integration and differentiation. This is roughly summing. This is roughly summing up. Sum. And this is little geometric, or actually cutting down the, this is cutting down the quadratic or higher terms, or linearization. Linearization. Okay. So this is towards addition, and this is towards making the higher terms also linear. So if there is a graph something like this, then don't look at this graph. You look at only the linear part of it. A linear part of it. That is differentiation. Okay. And these two processes are interrelated. Okay. We will see later. And all this was studied by this entire Madhava school. And that was greatest contribution of this entire Kerala school, that they invented calculus. Okay. They were studying astronomy, That was major interest. While doing so, they ended up doing calculus also in a very beautiful way also. That also I will discuss. So this is roughly thought of as, this is a river, but at the bank of this river, Sangama Grama is the place, and this today's name is Irinjala Kuda. So maybe you can now also Google this place. This is modern name of that same place, Sangama Grama, or this is the modern name. This is between Kochi and Calicut. Okay. So now earlier the name was Cochin. Now it is called Kochi. And Calicut, I will write because it is easy to write. Calicut. But there is other name called Kozhikode. Okay. And this is also Cochin. So these are same, one and the same. And this is a beautiful piece of land, strip of land in between these two. Okay. And this place must be about 40 kilometers from Cochin or Kochi, you can say, modern name. I was fortunate to visit both these places, Kochi and Calicut. But so far, I have not visited this village. And I wish I will visit. I was about to visit, but due to laziness of people around me, I could not manage to go to Sangama Grama. I wanted to go, but I wanted people with me. I mean, somebody should take me there and so on, but then I missed it. So I want to go, but I visited this entire strip and saw this region, beautiful land. The sad part is even ancestors of this Madhava school or even Madhava or their family, they don't know about the greatness of their predecessors. And people are very reluctant to speak. First of all, language is a problem. It's a slightly undeveloped part of Kerala and things like that. But great history took place in this part. This is Neela River. Neela River, maybe. Neela Valley or Neela River. All right. So this was some biographical comments. Now let's talk about the work carried out by this Kerala school. So as I told you, these were Aryabhatta II and Bhaskaracharya II, were immediate predecessors of Madhava. They lived in about 12th century, 13th century, and Madhava came in 14th century. So as a natural consequence, Madhava, first of all, went through the works of Aryabhatta and Bhaskaracharya and digested the Indian way of doing mathematics, especially astronomy. Okay. Then we do not find direct evidence of writings by Madhava. That means we do not find a book written by Madhava, though the disciples of Madhava always attributed everything to Madhava. They said that he has done this and we are just writing this. So the methods come from Madhava, it is believed. And then the disciples only said that our guru has done all this, but we are just writing this. Some of my students are sitting in this lecture, they should remember this, that they should always say that guru has done everything and we are just writing, nothing else. Okay, I'm just joking. So they used to call Madhava as Gola Vida. That means one who knows. Okay, I should not write here. One who knows sphere. Sphere, a word used in means one who knows astronomy very well. One who knows the astronomy very well. Knowing sphere means knowing this earth, knowing the astronomical objects. Yeah. So though there is no direct evidence of writings by Madhava, everything ultimately is attributed to Madhava. Okay. Then I talked about Parmeshwara, who lived very long, 95 years, and he produced 25 volumes. There is some evidence of actually written work by from Madhava school. And the main area of interest was, of course, astronomy. And so many astronomical methods, actually so many recordings of eclipses, you will be able to find in the work of Parmeshwara. Series of eclipses and the observations, astronomical observations, with almost bare naked eyes, these people carried out, and they pondered upon it, studied it, thought on it, and produced great work in that period on astronomy. Then I talked about Nilakanta, who was disciple of Damodara. Damodara was Parmeshwara's son, and Nilakanta was actually disciple of Damodara. And Nilakanta wrote this book, Tantra Sangraha, extremely important book. And this book gives complete rational justification of what Aryabhatta has done. So Aryabhattiya, that the work carried out by Aryabhatta too, was completely put on logical terms in Tantra Sangraha by Nilakanta. So that is contribution in terms of, you know, the Indian mathematics up to Aryabhatta. There was a need that somebody will explain it on the basis of more logical foundation and not just some kind of ad hoc arguments. So Nilakanta in this Tantra Sangraha itself means that techniques of proving things he has given in this book. Excellent book this is. One of the most prolific contributions in this Madhava school is this book, Yukti Vasha. This is thought of as first textbook of calculus. So if one wants to look at a book on calculus, okay, now in the history that is written so far, people will not say Yukti Vasha, but some book by some British school or Newton, Leibniz, okay. But now it is recognized that the first excellent textbook where you will find results, proofs, methods on calculus is Yukti Vasha. And I will refer to you article by Professor Divakaran, I will give references, who has given description of the techniques of Indian mathematics as it appeared in Yukti Vasha, and in fact he has proved his hypothesis that this is in fact the first textbook on calculus. And then I talked about Shankara, who was disciple of both Nilakanta and Jyeshtadeva, and he produced another important contributions. Yukti Deepika is commentary on Tantra Sangraha, Yukti Bhasha, and Kriya Kramakari, this is based on Lilavati. So as I told you, so this is by Bhaskaracharya and this is by Aryabhatta. So Madhava school commented, made clear the works of earlier Indian mathematicians, major Indian mathematicians, that is Aryabhatta and Bhaskaracharya. So it is clear that they went through the contributions of Aryabhatta and Bhaskaracharya. They made critical analysis of the methods and wrote important books based on this Lilavati as well as Aryabhatta. So that is very remarkable research kind of work, because you take up from where it was done and then start from that point and carry forward. Okay, now while going through astronomical objects, it is always immediate that pi will surface, because wherever curvilinear objects appear, pi comes into picture. And in this course also we discussed many things on pi. So pi is an irrational number, pi is transcendental number, and pi is a mysterious number. There is groups, communities, they form circles to discuss pi and so on. So we have talked so much on pi in this lecture series also. So naturally, every school of mathematics will think on pi, and Madhava school is not an exception. So let's see. This is before Madhava, much before Madhava. This is Aryabhatta 1, in fact. So this, there is a crude approximation in the works of Aryabhatta. Chaturadhikam Shatamashtagunam Dvashishtastha Sahastranam Ayuta Dvaya Vikashmasya Asanno Vritta Parinaha. So Chaturadhikam Shatamam means 100 plus 1. One can actually find out meaning out of this. Directly, this shloka has written for finding the value of pi, remember. They wrote mathematics in Sanskrit. So this Sanskrit stanza actually gives rise to the value of pi. It's given. Dvashishtastata means 62,000. Sahastranam, 62,000. So on. So, okay. Ayuktadvaya, that is 20,000. You can, those who are good at Sanskrit can actually see word by word and see this. So this stanza is written for finding pi. But this value is just little crude, 1415, but still looking at this period, it is great approximation to what is correct value of pi. There is no correct value, but up to certain decimal. Okay. Then Bhaskara 2 has found, again, I will not read out this, little difficult to read also. Vyase, Vananda, Gnihate, Vivakte, Kavana, Surya, Paridhi, Susakshma, Bhavishya, Jagne. You may try to read it. So this is 3.1416 again. Okay. Now let's see Madhava's contribution to pi. So this Shankara writes Madhavacharya puna atopya santamam parigas. So he has found from circle. Okay. Circumference upon diameter. See, this coding of words for numbers. So 33, Mandar, can you see these numbers? 33, 2, 8, 8. Can all of you see these numbers?
Yes.
Vibhuda means 33. Netra means 2. Gaja means 8. So those who know this coding, they will be able to decipher the meaning of this shloka. Madhava Acharya Puna Vibhudena Vibhudena Vibhudanetra Gaja. Can somebody read this?
Yes.
Please.
Vibhudanetra Gaja Gaja, actually it should be Gajahi Hutashana Triguna Veda Bhavaranam Bahavaha Navikarvan Mite Vritti Vistare परिघि मानम इदम जगुदुर जगदुर बुधा हा पाइजे थे.
ओके ओके. व्हाट आई एम इंटरेस्टेड इन इज दैट दिस नंबर्स हैव बीन कोडेड. विबुधा इज 33, नेत्र इज 2. सो यू राइट, यू रीड फ्रॉम राइट साइड 33 टू 8 8 दैट इज हताशन अहि गजहि. सी गजहि इट मींस Gaja and Ahi, that is 8, 8 is appearing here. 1, 3 is mysterious, little mysterious, but then next three are there. Okay, that is Hutashana Triguna. These 2, 3 are there. Then 4 is there. This Veda, see Veda. Then you have 27. 27 is Nakshatra. Bha, that is 27. And then 8 again. Okay, Varana. Okay, this Varana. And this 2 is Bahu. And denominator is 9 into 10 raised to 11. Navanikarva. Navanikarva. So if you carry out this operation, so he's describing certain circle whose diameter is 9 into 10 raised to 11, then circumference has to be this. That is what Madhava claims. And therefore, value of pi is this. Now, this is correct to 11 decimals, which is astonishing, which is extremely great. This is correct to 11 decimal places. Now, the Madhava school comes up in this particular period, say 15th century, with value of pi up to 15 decimal is amazing. It's not easy. And this is clear-cut evidence. These are shlokas from Madhava school. So they have actually found it out. Correct up to 11, yes, written there. Now, this word infinite series, some of you may not know. How many of you, do you know what infinite series means? Many of you don't know, but doesn't matter much. So infinite series means you add infinitely many numbers. Now, apparently it doesn't make sense, but then you give some sense to it. You add only finitely many and do the limiting process. So it is some analytic analysis comes into picture. Some calculus comes into picture, you may say, and then you add this infinite series. Now, by this was typical way of doing mathematics in Kerala school. So Kerala school gave many infinite series, not just one. So infinite series was their business, actually. Infinite series, their industry. Infinite series. This is one of the great contributions. So they found so many infinite series because they realized that things are not finite. If you want to deal with pi, or if you want to deal with astronomical objects, then you cannot express it in finite terms. So you need to have infinite series. But for understanding infinite series, you need to know calculus, you need to know analysis, you need to know limiting processes in some sense. And they actually then invented those processes. That is great. So they proved these infinite series, in some sense, convergence. See, I will tell you a great thing. Later generation European mathematicians had to prove convergence of infinite series. Actually, Euler wrote infinite series like this without convergence, very daringly. But after Euler, like Cantor, Dedekind, Weierstrass, in particular Weierstrass, actually was very meticulous in proving that the infinite series is convergent. Whereas in Kerala school, the convergence is apparent in the geometrical figure, because everything that is under consideration is certain geometrical, is bounded by certain geometrical object. So it has to converge. So method of convergence was very, very elegant in Madhava school, much, much, much more elegant than later generation European technical analytic school of mathematics, I will say, which includes Cantor, Dedekind, Weierstrass, Cauchy, people like that. They had remainder terms, this term, that term, limit. But in Madhava's work, you will find a geometric object which bounds all this, which is extremely important. Saroj, can you read it?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, please.
Vyase varidhi nihate ruparute vyasa sagaravihate trisharadi vishama sankhya bhaktam runam svam prithak kramat kuryat.
Yes, that means four times diameter vyase varidhi nihate vishama sankhya bhaktam divide by odd numbers alternating in sign. So they are talking about this series. Four times diameter into this particular series. Now you will see this dot, dot, dot. This means this is infinite sum. But mind well, though this is infinite sum, this sum is finite. You can add actually this by giving certain meaning to how to add. Okay. So this is an alternating series. And very importantly, you can, there is a finite number which comes out of it. That number multiplied by diameter of the circle into 4 will give rise to circumference. This is formula for Madhava. This is formula by Madhava. One of the greatest contributions that you can, suppose if you want to write a single line contribution from the Madhava school, I will choose this, because this is later on called as Newton-Gregory series. Okay, so this was attributed to Newton. In literature, you will find Newton-Gregory series. Because if you divide by this diameter here, circumference by diameter, that will be pi, further divide, then this will represent pi by 4 actually. Pi by 4. Now that was one of the greatest contributions of Madhava. I wish I could have given a proof of this. Proof is so beautiful. But then this lecture will not allow me, and not in terms of content as well as time. But I have written one book in Marathi on Madhava's contributions, where you can find the complete proof of how this formula got. So this is my opinion, is the greatest work that Madhava has produced, in this pi by 4 series, Newton-Leibniz series. they further made research on this. Why? They made some comments, because this is a slow convergence series. See, if you this earlier, if you want to find out pi up to suppose 3 decimal places, then you may need to take thousands of terms in this series. This dot dot dot, further 1,000 terms you may need to take. Then add, then you will get pi up to say 3, 4. That means it is slow convergent. But Madhava recognized that the series is slow convergent, and then he made estimates on the remainder term, and that is called Anta Samskara. So on last term, there is some additional term. So if you want to stop at odd p, then something like this is to be added: p plus 1 by 2 upon p plus 1 by 2 bracket square plus 1, some factor like this, okay, most probably this, is to be added, and then you add the sum. It then will go very close to what you actually want, up to certain decimal at least of pi. Now, okay, I could have asked Dhanashri to read this, but then it's okay, you can read if you want. But this is in the question answer section.
Can I read?
Yeah, please read.
Katham punaha atra mahur visham sankhya haranena labhasya parighehe asannatvam antya sankarena apayate uchyate tatra tavad ukta rupaha samskaraha sukshmo na veti prathamam nirupaniyam tadartham यया कदाचित् विषम संख्यया हरणे कृते पृथक् संस्कारं कुर्यात् अथ तद् उत्तर विषम संख्या हरणात् अनन्तरं च पृथक् संस्कारं कुर्यात् एवं कृते लब्धौ परिघी यदि तुल्यौ भवतः तर्हि संस्कारः सूक्ष्म इति निर्णीयतां कथम्।
ग्रेट, वंडरफुल, नाइस रीडिंग। Okay, so here there is a discussion on why there is infinite series. Okay, there is a discussion in Madhava school that why infinite series. They are asking questions. Okay, this is in terms of question answer. Okay, typical of the Guru Shishya Parampara. So they are wondering that if you divide circumference by diameter, why you cannot get accurate value. See, this will be in terms of pi. So they are wondering that why you cannot actually find out this circumference of diameter. Why you cannot find directly the value of this? Why there is something missing and something that you want to add and again subtract and again add? Why this sanskara to be done? Visama sankhyayam, you subtract the negative terms, then something remains. Sukshmo na veti prathamam. So something remains means the ratio has to be infinitesimal. Ratio has to be expressed in infinite terms that they have understood, and they are asking why is it so. And later on there is answer to this also given by the scholars in Madhava school at that time, that this is because circumference and diameter are not commensurate, that is the ratio cannot be rational. So here they are actually talking about irrationality of pi, because they are saying that this ratio cannot be expressed in terms of finite terms or repeated term. That means a decimal which is neither finite nor recurring. They did not use the word irrational, but now such quantities we call irrational numbers. Okay, so some number which cannot have decimal expansion, which is finite or recurring, has to be irrational number. And that's what they are wondering, that this ratio, circumference to diameter, why it is so? This is not rational. That's what the discussion goes on. Now, this is by Newton, and Newton describes how infinite series are important. Remember, expressing certain quantity, okay, or a function in modern language in terms of infinitesimal, okay, infinite, 1 to infinity, 1 to infinity, is extremely important notion. This is very important notion. And this series expansion look at what Newton says. So this is directly by Newton. Okay, the ingenious method of expressing every possible number using a set of 10 symbols, each symbol having a place value and an absolute value, seems so simple nowadays that significance and profound impact are no longer appreciated. See, actually, decimal system we understand, but if you go into details, it's not a finite process. A number, okay, see the number. So Newton number means, I think, real number. You cannot express any significant unless you use infinite series. Okay, the idea of expressing all quantities by nine figures, whereby is imparted to them both a position and absolute value, is so simple that this very simplicity is the reason for not being sufficiently aware how much admiration it deserves. See, we think that, okay, 0 to 9 numbers are given, decimal system is there, and you can write number 3, 1, 4, 5, something like this. What is big deal? Newton said it's not, its simplicity is the reason not sufficiently aware. So decimal expansion, he's praising decimal expansions. And decimal expansion directly is related to infinite series. Okay, decimal expansion is nothing but infinite series. So this is about 100, 200 years after Madhava school that Newton appreciates greatness of infinite series. Whereas we saw that there are so many infinite series that Madhava school, this pi by 4 is one, but this Madhava school, they came up with infinite series for sine, cos, tan inverse. Okay, so see this. These are all infinite series coming from Kerala school, much, much before Newton. They had tan inverse series, they have binomial series, then while finding instantaneous velocity of planet, they came up with certain series, binomial series, geometric series, series expansion of trigonometric functions. So much 100 or 200 years before Newton, this series expansions were very rigorously studied by Madhava school. After quoting a verse from Bhaskara 2 on names of powers of 2, Jyeshthadeva says, if we endow numbers with multiplication and positional variation, sthana bhedam, there is no end to the names of numbers, hence we cannot know all the numbers themselves and their order. See, even if you take finite number of symbols, you can generate by recursive methods an infinite set. See, this is exactly what is done in languages by Panini and Patanjali. See, the set of symbols, linguistic symbols, are finite, and set of logical rules to be applied on that is also finite. But if you put those rules and these symbols in a recursive method, then infinity is born, infinity is generated. So recursion is capable of generating infinite set out of finite numbers. And that is main technique of ancient Indian mathematics. So recursive methods. And this is evidence long back. This is roughly 500 BC, I think. Patanjali and this, Panini and Patanjali is say 300 roughly, because Patanjali is disciple of me. So this recursive methods is the backbone of the Indian mathematics. Okay, backbone of Indian mathematics, Indian methods. And that is therefore very much apparent in Yukti Bhasha. Okay. So I will not now get into these details because we are running short of time. See this, Kerala school techniques used continuation of the tradition of Indian mathematics. That's what I told, that is nothing but the recursive methods. Recursive methods naturally generates infinity. Therefore, Indian mathematicians have studied infinity rigorously. However, the credit of limits, continuity, differentiation, integration, all these are typical infinitesimal processes is given to the Western school, because this is an unsung story, because this never came into picture. This was never thought of very seriously. See, the recursive Indian method reached its pinnacle in Kerala school. It started from 500 BC, recursive methods, and its pinnacle is in the Kerala school. All the methods of proving this infinite series is by recursive methods. So if you see my book, or you may read higher books like Kim Faulkner, Divakaran, because, you know, partly I have taken proofs, but I have simplified. And those who want to read Marathi, there is a facility. But then it is very clear from the geometric proofs that the methods are recursive. Okay. Indian mathematicians never used a reductio absurdum method, that is contradictory method, contradiction, method by contradiction. That is, suppose what we want to prove is not true and then arrive at contradiction. No, they always use direct methods. The proofs are constructive and using recursive methods. So this is typical of Indian mathematics. This is methodology I am discussing. Naturally encompassing the notion of infinity. That's what I told, that recursive will give rise to infinity. And geometric description of differentiation. So infinity is embedded into geometric figures. So that is another great contribution of Indian mathematics, especially Madhava. Now this appearance of fundamental theorem of calculus is amazing things. So this is relation between differentiation and integration. I wish I would have written this statement that if you integrate a function and differentiate under this, then you get. I am very writing very roughly. I can write more rigorously, and there are various versions and so on. Okay, so integrate this, and then you will get this. Okay. There is another formula also, that is differentiate first and integrate first, and integrate first and differentiate later. Then you again get a function. These are fundamental theorems. So ignore this if you don't want to get into mathematical details. But the relation between differentiation and integration is very, very clear in Madhava's work while proving the Newton-Gregory formulae. So that is another great contribution. So main features of calculus are all there much before Newton and Leibniz. So the credit given to Newton and Leibniz for inventing calculus, perhaps we may need to think on this. So invention of calculus before Newton and Leibniz. Mumford is Fields medalist, a modern day mathematician, in his review of Kim Faulkner's book, says that it seems fair to me to compare Madhava to Newton and Leibniz. His work remained unnoticed. Historians started paying attention in last week. This work remained unnoticed. I will tell that how it remained unnoticed, that there was a person called Wisch, Charles Wisch. In 1892, he presented a paper, 1892. Of course, England, in front of scholars in Royal Academy, where he presented four palm leaves, very interesting palm leaves, which he found in Kerala actually. And these four palm leaves, there were manuscripts written. He found those leaves in Kerala. He presented that in front of British scholars also. These were pages from actually Yukti Bhasha. But still they did not pay much attention. He tried to present that this is some significant work which I found on palm leaves in India near Kerala. And there are some methods written on it. There is some calculus written on it maybe. Of course, there was already calculus in that period, but then there was not much attention. And then historians started paying in last 50 years only. I told you, first it is 1940, some Indian mathematician wrote about Madhava's work. Towards the end of the lecture, I will come to Madhava mathematics competition. So this competition was started in 2009-10 by our college, initiated by SP College. And we purposefully gave name Madhava. Some senior mathematicians suggested also. But then this was very appropriate name because now the competition has grown. Initially, first year, some 800 students appeared when we conducted this as a pilot project. But now there are about 10,000 students registered last year. So it has grown to that extent. Okay, 10 times almost. 10 times it goes. So, and it is conducted in 23 regions across the country. Includes all the major cities like Delhi, Calcutta, Mumbai, Bangalore, Chennai, Ahmedabad, all major cities it is conducted. And wherever this competition is conducted, then we send a poster on which this Newton-Leibniz series replaced by Madhava series. So people come to know. So for 10 years, SP College is trying to propagate the work of Madhava through this Madhava competition. And the competition is gaining a lot of importance. Now people have realized, partly due to competition, partly due to various articles, books, and so on, that Madhava is actually the founder of calculus. And the credit for inventing calculus should be given to this Kerala school, the mathematicians in Kerala school. See, it's not easy to perceive the subject like calculus, where infinitesimal operations are involved, where differentiation is involved. The concept of differentiation, as we think of, you know, Newton constructed this infinitesimal motion and so on. Newton's interest was dynamics of moving objects, how objects move, why objects move, and how they move. And see, there is one should not claim of the transfer of knowledge. There is ambiguity in this. There are question marks. So we don't want to claim at this stage that this something that was done in India went to Europe and from that Newton invented calculus. No, that may not be the case. Newton was very original, very prolific mathematician, and perhaps he invented calculus on his own. Okay. There are some people who believe that mathematics went from India to Europe and some hint to European mathematicians came from India, but that is a gray area and we don't want to get into that also. But certainly, for very sure, much before Newton Leibniz, calculus was invented by Madhava. And on the background of great Indian mathematics tradition of arithmetic, astronomy, and algebra, another great piece of area came into Indian mathematics as formed by them, founded by them, is calculus. Through this great Kerala school, though we call it an unsung story, I am sure that through our efforts, and if we talk more about Madhava, if we propagate his name, if we tell our children, if we tell next generation that there was a mathematics school of more than 200 years in Indian tradition, and they created calculus, they made significant contributions in the infinite series, astronomy, and so on, I am sure that in next 20, 25 years or so, it will be completely clear that the calculus was founded by Madhava. I always feel that unless it goes into curriculum, so where 11th standard mathematics, when first time students learn calculus, there itself in the textbooks of 11th standard, it should be mentioned. Then it will quickly get into public. Something reaches in the public if it goes through the system. So if we send it through the system, that is textbooks of 11th standard and 12th standard, so those teachers, some of you are involved in writing 11th standard, 12th standard textbook, I urge that put Madhava's name when you discuss calculus. Okay. So that's how I wanted to sing the story of Kerala school and this Madhava and all his disciple, Parameshwara, Damodara, Nilkanta, all great mathematicians. They produce a lot of mathematics. Now it is available in terms of books also. This Malayalam Sanskrit, Yukti Bhasha is in Malayalam, but now English translation is available. So those who are interested can read these textbooks also. They are very interesting. These recursive methods you can see, geometric methods you will be able to see. So these are references. All these books you will find. This book is very nice. I will recommend this. George Leverages Joseph, Christoph Peacock. Of course, this is most favorite, where all detailing has been done, what Madhava has done, and all the socio-political background of Kerala, where it is located, everything is there. Thank you very much.